Hi, I'm Whitney Espich, the CEO of the MIT Alumni Association, and I hope you enjoy this digital production created for alumni and friends like you.
Good morning. I want to talk about the theme of today's sessions, MIT on climate change, and I gave it the subtitle, Tackling the Big Problems. And what I want to do is to give you two vignettes, one tackling big problems in energy and one tackling big problems in manufacturing. And it's got to be a flyby because we want to keep the time. So first one is electricity. Electricity is tantamount to modernity. Everything that we value as a 21st century lifestyle is predicated on the availability of electricity. Where you see light, you see the modern world. Where you don't see light, there's one of two conditions. Either nobody lives there or it hasn't been electrified. And if it hasn't been electrified, there's no more precious gift that you can give those people than electricity, access to electricity. But we want sustainable modernity, and that means sustainable electricity, and that's going to mean carbon-free generation, wind, solar, but they're intermittent, and since they're intermittent, they're incapable of being fully integrated into baseload generation. Storage, stationary storage, that's the key. Without stationary storage, we cannot draw electricity from the sun when the sun doesn't shine. But it's very difficult. It has to have super long service lifetime, not like 3 years, 5 years in your laptop computer. Lithium ion on the grid has never been demonstrated. Safe, you can't have fires. Fire in a phone is one thing, but a fire in a 10 megawatt hour storage facility is something you don't want to see. Operationally flexible, it has to do everything from sprint to marathon. Frequency regulation, short duration, overnight, long duration, single battery has to do all of this. You don't have the battery that runs the hearing aid run an electric car, but this has to do everything. And it has to go at super low cost. And it has to be all of these. I can give you the top three right now to a NASA price point. But when you say low cost, that's a different matter, all right? So when I started my work, because it had to be low cost, I flipped the paradigm. You know, the paradigm for research in the university is invent the coolest chemistry, get the high impact journal publication, and maybe there's a startup company in there somewhere, and those guys will chase down the cost curve. That doesn't work here, because you're up against deeply entrenched incumbents. You gotta think about cost on day one, not day 1001. So I made cost the beginning of it. And I said, it's not battery versus battery. Don't ask me about other batteries. There are no batteries on the grid that are being deployed unless they're being heavily subsidized. We're competing against hydrocarbons. So I have to think differently. So I said, confine the chemistry to earth-abundant elements. There's a vast swath of the periodic table I won't allow my students to touch because this, I don't care. If you make a battery out of that stuff, it won't scale. So don't waste your time. I say, if you want to make something dirt cheap, make it out of dirt. And make it local dirt. Because that way you got a secure supply chain. It makes no sense to trade in your dependence on imported petroleum for dependence on imported neodymium. And make it easy to manufacture. Battery plant, lithium-ion battery plant costs $5 billion. Yeah, they call it a gigafactory because it costs $5 giga. That's crazy. Make it simple, make it primitive. So think about design already at the discovery stage. And pose the right question. I did not say, how do I invent a big battery? I didn't use the word battery. I said colossal storage device. I didn't specify the form. My colleagues are trying to figure out how to take the battery in this device here and make it the size of this room. I didn't start with that. Got to have an open mind. And by the way, do not speak to the incumbents. Disregard the conventional wisdom. If you're not going to get to brilliant, radical innovations if you consult with the incumbents. So I took my inspiration from outside the field of storage. My other area of research is electrochemistry as applied to metals production, aluminum, magnesium, and so on, high temperature. And here's a modern aluminum smelter. That's about 100 feet from left to right. Probably goes back about a mile. It's producing aluminum 24/7. That's probably 500,000 amps, 4 volts. That's 2 gigawatts. Now, I looked at that thing, and I said, and takes dirt to metal for less than 50 cents a pound. So I know that's big, it traffics in huge amounts of electricity, and it operates cheaply. So I said, if I can figure out how to make this thing not consume electricity, but to store electricity and give it back on demand, I know I'm going to have something big and cheap. So I started with something that's big and operates with huge amounts of electricity and said, I'm going to teach it how to store. Everybody else starts with something that stores electricity, tries to figure out how to make it big. We'll see who gets there. So this is the invention. It's the liquid metal battery. Three layers of liquid metal on top, liquid metal, molten salt in between, and a liquid metal on bottom. So the liquid metal is insoluble in the molten salt. Molten salt is insoluble in the liquid metal. So these three layers lie on top of one another by just density. No problem. And so on discharge, the magnesium wants to alloy with the antimony. But magnesium, I just said, it's insoluble in the salt. But if it ionizes, it can go. So it ionizes, sends the electrons through the external circuit, and then the magnesium goes down to the antimony, where now it has to come out of the salt. It acquires two electrons and becomes a neutral, which alloys with the antimony. The electrons have gone through the external circuit. And by the way, when the current passes, it generates heat. That's the threat in a lithium-ion battery. Here, I capture that heat, and I use that heat to keep this thing at temperature. Now, to recharge the battery, I force current through it and send the magnesium back to the top, and I'm essentially running an electrorefinery, so I'm purifying the antimony, purifying the salt, and making pure magnesium on the top, restoring the battery to its pristine initial state. And that was it. And there's a lot more to this, but I don't have the time. But I do want to say, I do want to say that that this is not just cook and look. I mean, people look at this and they say, ooh, this is heavy industry. Yeah, it's heavy industry, because that's where the solutions to the climate problems lie. I don't work in nano. It's too small. I don't want tens of atoms. I want tons of atoms. My students are also conducting scientific research. This is one of our papers in Nature, arguably the premier scientific journal in the world. And so this is going concomitantly. So there is the opportunity for good science and living in harmony with heavy industry. All right, startup time. I didn't want a startup company, but two of my students said, no, we have to have a startup. I said, I don't want that money stuff and so on. They said, do you want to have an impact on society? That was the hook. Science and service to society. That's why we have a company, because the paper in Nature doesn't make the world a better place. It's just a start. You have to get the technology out there. So all the catchy names were taken. We had this terrible name, the Liquid Metal Battery Corporation. Well, we thought about it. Somebody told me Cisco Systems was named because it was founded in San Francisco. So I looked at it. I said, we founded the battery. I invented it here in Cambridge. So I got the name Ambry, because Ambry comes out of Cambridge. And Ambry.com was still available. So that was sort of an ohm. All right. Series A funding. Bill Gates. Now, I'm from Canada. I'm polite. I wouldn't dare go to Bill Gates. He came to me. Why? It's an MIT story. You'll love this. For years, I was teaching 3091, Introduction to Solid-State Chemistry, and it was put on. Yeah. So it got put on OpenCourseWare. And somewhere around 2005, Bill started watching my chemistry lectures. I mean, all of them. He watched them all. He watched them every year. And I'm not making this up. In August of 2009, I got an email from a woman who said she was his executive assistant. He was coming to Boston at the end of September. He wanted to meet with me. Would I have 90 minutes? I ignored the email. Why? Because I thought the students had hacked into my account. So about 10 days later, she writes again and said, maybe you didn't see, but Mr. Gates really wants to meet you. So I showed the thing to a few people, and they said, I think this is real. So I said, okay, fine, I'll agree to meet him. It was a Friday. I just finished teaching 3091. We sat for 90 minutes and we chatted about, you know, he was really focused. He talked about the lectures. He criticized some of the camera work and talked about computers and distance learning and all this stuff. And towards the end, he says, what are you working on? And this was 2009. I had no results yet. I sketched out on a whiteboard this concept of a liquid metal battery. And he said, that's interesting. So if you ever decide to spin that out, let me know. I'd be willing to put some money into it. And a year later, my students approached him, and he became our first investor. So I met Bill Gates not because I wrote a dynamite opinion piece in the Wall Street Journal. I met Bill Gates because I taught freshman chemistry at MIT. And now, the other investor was Total, which had just joined the MIT Energy Initiative. Big, one of the majors, petroleum companies, thinking about 30 years hence. They wanted to invest. They were buying Sun Power. They knew that solar without storage was incomplete. And they looked and looked and looked for something radical. And they said, this liquid metal battery, that's different. So that's how we got started. Okay. And I'll just show you one thing. This is 4.5 years at temperature, 5,000 cycles, 5,000 full discharge cycles, which would be tantamount to 13 years if you did it once a day. And here it is after 4,000 cycles, still retaining 99% capacity. Okay, we've got to keep moving. Now I'm going to go to manufacturing. So a few fun facts about steel. Last year, 1.8 billion tons of new metal, which is up 2x from 20 years ago and up 10x from 1950. And when steel is made, iron oxide reacts with carbon, and so that generated 3 gigatons of CO2. 3 gigatons of CO2 represents 9% of total CO2. Not 9% that went to manufacturing, came from manufacturing. 9% of total CO2 came from world steel. This is big. And this is how steel is made. Blast furnace, the heart. To make a ton of pig iron, you need over a ton of iron oxide as iron ore. You're going to use 3/4 of a ton of coal, which you're going to convert to coke. You got to throw in some limestone as slag, flux. All right. So I started thinking about this about 25 years ago. It's been a long journey, little by little, trying to get funding and so on. But I'm persistent. So I know iron's found in nature as an oxide. I know the electron can be produced sustainably. And like dissolves like. I got that not from density functional theory. I got that from teaching 3091. All right? And so I conceived of molten oxide electrolysis. So you're going to take an oxide, dissolve it in a molten oxide as the flux, and the electron is going to produce electrolysis, and so we will have a radical form of electrolysis and produce oxygen as the byproduct. There's the cell, anode at the top. Iron oxide goes into the electrolyte, make liquid iron at the bottom, oxygen gas off the top. And so that means we replace the basic oxygen furnace and the blast furnace with electrolysis, and we don't need iron ore pelletizer, we don't have to sinter, we don't need coke, we don't need the coal injection, we don't need the limestone. So this thing's going to be a lot cheaper. Better metal, cheaper. Not better metal at a premium. No one pays premium for green because that's the impediment, so we've got to make it better. And it scales at much lower tonnage. So here we are in the basement of building 4. And this is a furnace that's running at about 1600 degrees C, molybdenum disilicide windings and so on. And here we are looking down and you'll see gas coming off the anode at the top and then making a liquid iron on the plate off to the bottom. And then came the discovery of a practical inert anode, a ferrochromium alloy that passivates. So now we have all the elements. And by the way, there was a paper in Nature on this. Nature publishes probably one paper per year in the area of extractive metallurgy. It's not au courant. All right, so we started another company, Boston Metal. And okay, well, let's jump through this. These are the people that sponsored us. We just finished the Series A, including MIT Engine, but I'm gonna show you the cool stuff. So this is the reactor here. This is about a meter in diameter. It's 10,000 amperes. We're tapping molten iron at 1600 degrees C. While current is still flowing. So this is done. This is real. Molten electrolysis has arrived. We've also produced nickel from nickel oxide. We put chromium oxide in and electro-reduced to chromium. But the chromium melts at 1900 degrees, which is a little bit high. So we used iron as the host and took chromium oxide and made carbon-free ferrochromium. So now I've shown you that I can make iron, nickel, chromium. That means I can make virgin stainless steel. And then the other thing that we've done, but I didn't put it into this slide deck, we took titanium oxide and in one step went to liquid titanium. Titanium melts at about just under 1700, which is doable. Yeah. There we are. So what I've shown you here, so I've shown you two examples of tackling big problems, trying to show how you take the fundamental science and then think about scale, cost, and so on. And I'll close with what I urged of my students. This is from Paris, 1968. Right? Be realistic. Ask for the impossible. And you know, sometimes when you're at MIT, with enough ingenuity, the impossible sometimes becomes the inevitable.
Thanks for joining us. And for more information on how to connect with the MIT Alumni Association, please visit our website.